alert at 4 in the afternoon after a long day. I'm just going to take a second to explain a little bit about who I am, because sometimes that's helpful. I haven't had a chance to interact with anybody yet. I grew up probably an empath, more than likely, very sensitive at a young age. Was always sort of searching and trying to understand what makes us tick as human beings. And that journey has taken me literally all over the earth. And along the way, I've picked up a few things that made sense for me. And I think, you know, one of the things I've learned as a doctor is that everybody's got something that's a little bit different that makes sense for them. And so I, at this point, I'm an internal medicine doctor. I'm trained in hospice and palliative medicine, so I have quite a bit of work with the death and dying process, distinct from what we're talking about here. A longer journey in some cases. And then I spent time in India studying Ayurveda and Kundalini Yoga, and I converted, I guess you could say, to the Sikh religion. So that's my garb, you could say. And I wear white to expand my aura, because I'm, without it, I'm kind of sinking. So a lot of times people are real curious about that when they see me. Why do you wear the white? And why do you have a turban? And why is your name Surichand? And so, you know, these are things that sometimes I find are helpful to just kind of address. And so I'm going to speak to you from the lens of all that experience, all these years of sort of studying, you know, what is this? What's happening here? And, you know, as they commonly say, the more you know, the less you know. And so every day, every person I interact with, every patient I see, I'm humbled more at how little we really are at understanding. And that's what I really liked when I went to study Ayurveda, because they studied the human condition for thousands of years. And what I really want to focus on for you all today is something called Dinacharya. This is the daily routine. The Dinacharya is your daily routine. It's your daily self-care physical body program. So we're learning these fantastic mental, emotional, spiritual self-care. But in so much as that I'm that primary care doctor that's like, you know, what's going on here? I'm going to give you that lens of the physical body. So there's four main pillars that I like to think about. And I'm so grateful you already touched on one of them. And that's one of the main pillars is loving connection or loving interaction or human contact. Sometimes when we're going through a grieving process, we isolate. It's really normal, actually. There's periods of time when we do need to be alone. There are three other pillars that I'll focus on a little bit more, but there are so many great ways to connect with people that can help you expand out and not feel quite as isolated. And I think these are workshops like this are a great way to start making those connections and follow up on them. These great people are here today. I can assure you I'm always looking for great referrals. I'm really enjoying hearing their presentations. There's three other areas that I want to focus on. Nutrition will be the third one and the one I'll put the most time to. But the second one is movement. And so we think about the body is holding the spirit and the soul. It's the lens that's being expressed through. And so if the body, if you've been through a difficult experience, what does the body often do, right? It closes, it comes in. We've got shoulders come down, we slump. What happens in your gut, right? What's one of the first things you notice if you, I don't want you to do it because I don't want anyone to feel bad, but if you had that difficult thought, you start pulling your abdomen tight. Well, think about that. That's one of the things that inhibits gut peristalsis, blood flow to the gut that's allowing for nutrient absorption. So all these things are maybe small, but not small. So even just taking a walk, and we know has anyone heard of foresting? Have you heard of that term? It's kind of new, it's in vogue, it's being studied. But basically, I always tell them, I was like, scientists and doctors like to study the obvious. It was a little pat on the back for the office. But there's a scientist in Japan, and I think it's called Shinroku, I don't remember exactly. But what they did is they found that people who lived in big cities, that if they actually went out into nature, their cortisol levels dropped, their heart rate variability evened out. So one of the things we know is that if we're processing a lot of strong emotional, mental, spiritual things, the body starts, cortisol comes up, tension comes up. So we want to think about things that might dial that back a little bit, or at least balance it. So believe it or not, spending time in nature nature has been studied and shown to be helpful for that. So, you know, one of the things that I say is that a lot of activities that we might do, going to the gym or a yoga class, there's kind of a give and take. There's an energy exchange, but nature just gives freely. Meaning you got into nature, you don't have to negotiate and say, well, nature, if I do this pose this way, I'll leave class this way. Nature's just pouring love onto your physical body, balancing you in ways that, and this is more of an Ayurvedic concept, it's very difficult to explain. But there are qualities of the earth that are we're constantly coming in contact with. And we say in nature that it's sattva. And sattva means the angelic realm. And in Ayurveda, we live in the angelic, animal, and human forms. You know, these are just terms. But nature is considered to be sattva, which means it just gives, it just loves. So just going, if you're going through a really difficult time, there's a bunch of trails through town. Get up in the early morning. The pre-dawn light has a very special impact on the chakras, the upper chakras, so the third eye, the crown chakra. It is nourished by that pre-dawn light when you're in nature. So just, you don't have to be crazy about it, because that's going to bring your cortisol up. But just taking that walk, that gentle walk, you can even do breath work as you go. So that's a second pillar, but just remembering to move, to balance that, the fact that when you're home, you're reading the email, you're trying to get in eight places at once, right? One part here is dealing with funeral arrangements, another part here is your job, are you going to have time off? Who's feeding the dog today? You know, we're often juggling so much when we're going through big transitions. The third pillar is sleep. And this one also, thank you, doctors, it's an obvious one, right? But I'm going to touch on just a few little ideas that you might find useful. So one of the things we know is that, just speaking very basically, that people who do a lot of shift work, their circadian rhythms are often disrupted. Or let's say you've been up crying for 3 weeks, and you can't actually sleep when your head hits the pillow. You're on the bed, and it's 2 a.m., and it's 6 a.m., you gotta work the next day, and your body's just tired, tired, tired. And you hit the pillow at 8:30 or 7 o'clock even sometimes, but you're up at 11, 12, 1 a.m. So one of the things, again, and this circles back, is that we think about that early morning light helping to reset those circadian rhythms. So just, even if you can't get out to, you know, God knows where here in the valley, it's an endeavor. But just if you can go out into your yard or into the street and let the light, that early morning light, hit the upper part of the body. The pineal gland sits, we think about it, in the middle. And this is part of what regulates sleep cycles. Another thing you can do, it's pretty easy, is remember to turn the lights down, right? So oftentimes we come home and we're like, I can't see the dog, I can't find my mail. So we turn all the lights up in the house, right? So it's 8 o'clock and it's 10,000 kilowatts if you'd be at a football game, right? So remember, if you're really having a hard time sleeping, remember to dim those lights when you come home at night. You can even get dimmers for your, you know, sometimes people find after traumatic events, it can take a very long time to sleep well again. And that's where finding other practitioners, healing touch, body work, all kinds of modalities, essential oils, things that really help you wind that tension and stress down. Another thing you can do, which is a favorite of mine, is called golden milk. And who has everybody heard of that these days? Yeah. It's really made the rounds. So I'll explain what it is really briefly. So golden milk is a paste with turmeric, and it's boiled. There's a lot of recipes. You can just Google it, golden milk. But it's a paste made with turmeric, and I'm a plant-based advocate, so I use a homemade nut milk of some kind, carrageenan free if you can. And you warm that up and drink that close to bed. And you can, if you work with a good doctor, there's some other botanicals you can add that help relax your body for sleep. But the turmeric milk, anybody can do. Add a little bit of cardamom, a little bit of honey for taste. It's very soothing. You might say it builds the aura, builds ojas, we say in Ayurveda. And it helps that the body remember, oh, I need sleep, I need to rest, I need to relax. You can also do guided meditation. there's a couple apps. There's some great options. You can use a little bit of essential oil. I'm sure somebody maybe mentioned things like that, but lavender is a real easy one. There's, again, working with a good skilled provider, you could come up with some individual blends. So, okay, so we're talking about these pillars, so human connection, and then we have, over here, we have exercise and movement, and then over here we have sleep. And so what we're thinking about is giving the physical framework for the body to process and work with the intensity of the mental, emotional, spiritual journey. So last, but of course very not least, is food. And one of the things that I've seen is that many people use food in an unhealthy way. I do.
I do.
Right? I'll be honest about it. So, and again, I'm going to go with the kind of my feeling too, that everybody in here is pretty sensitive. And so food has various roles in our life, right? Some of it's comfort, some of it's to quiet the mind, quiet the sensitivity. So if you think about, so for example, I'm really human. People sometimes say, what's going on over there? Totally human. So if I have a tough day, you know, sometimes my go-to will be like, I just want something fried, you know, like, just bring me some fried potatoes and lather it in vegan cheese, and I just want to not think. But I know that what's going to happen to me 2-3 days later from that, my gut's going to be all bound up, I'm going to be lethargic, I won't move my bowels, you know, it's like, So what I like to remind people is that we have a tremendous amount of social conditioning around food. And by no means do I have the bandwidth to give you my full kind of point of view about food and nutrition, but there's a couple of key points I want to point out to you. One of them is that some of the ways that the body's mediating our mood, especially when it feels heavy and dark, is through inflammation. So we're going to start seeing a lot more conversation about the treatment of depression as a model that's driven through inflammation. Now, of course, there are these other layers to it, but we're talking just purely physical. So like inflammatory pathways, things that lead the body more towards inflammation and gut health. Does anybody know how many bacteria? We're just a walking microbe home. We have 100 trillion bacteria, only about 10 to 30 trillion cells in our bodies. So there's actually more of them than us. Now the cells get bigger ratio-wise. But what we're understanding is that the health of these guys and what sort of inflammation pathways are active in the body actually has a really strong bearing on how we're feeling. And so one of the things I really encourage people to do is to look into something called the anti-inflammatory diet. And I'll just give you kind of the nutshell of it. It's essentially foundationally a Mediterranean diet. So at the basis of the platform, and of course we could argue paleo and vegan and low fat vegan, but let's just say as a basic platform we use the anti-inflammatory diet. So at the base of that we see that there's fresh fruits and vegetables. Now when's the last time you just mentally you had 10 servings of vegetables? Maybe been a little while, right? In one day. And that being like salad is one cup, is one serving of half cup of cooked vegetables. So if you could really think back to when the last time you had that much nutrient density, it's a treat for the body, trust me. When people start shifting and putting that much kind of fresh fruits and vegetables into their body. Now the second thing people always say to me, well, who has time to cut all those vegetables up and shop for everything? It's much easier for me to just go grab something from the store that's ready-made, pick it up, bring it home. And that's what I encourage people to just think about meal prep days. Take one day a week, cut all your vegetables, stick it in the fridge, use your one pot cooker, especially if you're going through a lot. Just throw a bunch of vegetables, and if you eat meat, a little bit of chicken, in that one pot. And when you come home from work, there's something warm, nourishing, lots of rich nutrients, vegetables, waiting for you. This is a really important concept because we know that foundationally, again, patting ourselves on the back as doctors, that more vegetables equals more health, literally there's like graphs that show that you eat one vegetable a day, you're going to die 15 years younger than someone who eats 8 vegetables a day. And that's of all cause reasons, cancer, dementia, heart disease. So it's really important to realize that those vegetables give your body the micronutrients and the phytonutrients that help mitigate inflammation. And that also includes healthy dietary fats, which everybody's got different opinions about this, but olive oil, coconut oil are certainly ones that aren't being argued at the moment. But again, it gets tricky. Nutrition gets tricky. And then I always like to encourage people, and again, this one's really tough, but that taste for the sweet, right? So there's two little concepts I'm just gonna share with you towards the closing part of my talk here, is that sweet is one of those things that, this is an Ayurveda concept, is very healing, actually. And I'm not talking refined white sugar, but the taste of sweet is actually, is anybody here study Ayurveda by any chance? A little bit, okay, so I won't use any of the Ayurvedic terms. But basically it helps relax the body, it's healing to the adrenal system, the sweet taste. So what is natural sweet taste? Fruit, of course, is one. Grains are actually the sweet taste. Believe it or not, have you ever thought about barley or rice or quinoa? They have, if you really do a sort of mindfulness moment, you'll notice that it has that activating sweet taste. So instead of reaching for a cookie, maybe, or a sweet, maybe try looking for something else that satisfies that sweet taste. Another thing I see a lot is that probably about this time, a lot of people will grab for a soda. This is the low time and energy in the day. And I encourage people to recognize that there's a natural rhythm to the day. And this is actually an okay time to have your energy be a little lower, but we're superimposing work and busy schedules on it. So, but a lot of people will reach mid-afternoon for a soda with caffeine, or a caffeinated, like a latte, Starbucks Deluxe, to really get them the boost they need to kind of get through the evening. But sometimes if you just honor the body wants to take a moment of quiet and regenerate itself, that those cycles, the energy will rise back as the sun sets, as the day progresses on. So I really try to encourage people who are going through a lot of mental, emotional, spiritual heaviness to try to get rid of all refined white sugar. That's a lot to ask, isn't it? It is.
Yeah.
But, you know, I will dare to ask it, if I may, because I, you know, I feel like there's a lot to be offered in terms of leveling your own mood out and reducing the inflammatory response in the body. The last little tip I'm going to share with you, just in terms of nutrition, is that in the Ayurvedic model, we talk about the movement of the sun through the day mimicking our digestive capacity. So midday is when our, again, I don't have any research for this one, but this is through their teaching, when digestion's at its peak. Well, when do most of us do our big meal? After the sun sets, right? So there's a lot of really fantastic literature, again, science slowly coming to pass, that intermittent fasting is actually quite good for weight loss. And so a lot of times people will be eating really healthy calories and healthy meals and tracking their macros, but they're not losing any weight. And they're just feeling stuck. And so sometimes I'll ask them to just try to minimize eating when the sun is set. Simple thing, but again, it's this conditioning we have, come home for our big meal. So coming home in the evening to a soup or a thinned out something that gives you that sense of fullness in your belly, but it's not quite as many calories in the evening time. It also helps you sleep better. Heavier meals are harder on the body to relax, to rest deeply. So, and the last thing I always encourage people to do to kind of help that digestive process move forward is to do hot water with lemon in the morning. So you wake up in the morning, and your body's sort of like the digestive tract, which, as I said, we're learning is totally key in health, physical health, is it's like little embers on a fire. You need to take your bellow and bring those embers up, right? I was thinking a lot this weekend about many patients often reflect to me, I just don't have time to cook and eat healthy anymore. And I thought, well, we've just reprioritized what we do with our days. At some point in time, majority of humanity's time was spent cooking, eating, preparing meals. So we have to probably find the balance in that. Now that we have more freedom to think more in more expansive ways, and we're not just surviving. But if you think about bringing those embers up as the day comes on, hot water with lemon and ginger tea before meals helps the body wake up, digestion be a little better. And when digestion is steady, interestingly enough, sometimes mood is steadier. So like if you don't move your bowel, do you ever notice that if you had a day where you're like, it didn't quite happen, right? You gotta feel a little more anxious, and then you know, get that release, the body feels like it's resetting itself. So let me just summarize kind of what we talked about. Sort of four areas that I think are really supportive to the physical body. And this is one of the things that allows for that deep inner growth, mental, emotionally, and spiritually, letting that physical body be healthy. And the first one is healing connection, loving connection. So important. And the second one is movement. Whatever that looks and feels like for you, but you kind of get a couple extra bonuses if you're out in that early morning sun on trails here in the desert. And the third one is getting that restful sleep, really letting the body recharge and reset itself. Oh, and most of you probably know there's a setting for your phones at night. I know how hard it is to turn the phone off. A lot of people go to bed with their phone, they're like cradling their phone. Right there. It never happens. At least do yourself a favor, get one of those EMF things for your phone that blocks some of the radiation. There's some little stickers and things, I don't know, but it seems worthwhile to do. And put your night settings on your phone. Get that, make sure you do that. There's a little setting on your iPhone that says nighttime, and it changes the light because that activates the brain differently. And then the fourth thing is just really looking at how food can nurture and being willing to work on some of those suppositions of your own conditioning about what equals diet and nutrition, being mindful, being respectful of the body. So, thank you.
That's great.